Again, this is what we explain the culture. You know, I got the homeboy here. We've already spoke. Of course, you guys been tuned in for the first, I think it was 15, 20 minutes that we had the conversation. And so we back, man. Westside, what's good, my brother?
Hey, man, for the lock in with you, man. I'm loving it.
Yes, Lord. Now, we kind of have already talked about, and we're going to continue to kind of hammer it home and make sure that the people understand that the quality of the individual that was behind the sparing of the young man, in which, you know, those consequences could have been different than you gave them. So, again, we got to affirm each other. I've just now learned that from again, Jason Wilson, just affirming another black man and said, bro, what you did was a beautiful thing. What you did, that was real nigga shit, bro. You held it down. You know what I'm saying? And it's for you to hold that. It ain't a nigga ain't supposed to say that to try to, because a lot of times with us, with black men, we'll tell each other that and a nigga instantly shoot it back. You know what I'm saying? Like, yo, man, I like what you're doing out there. You killing it. Oh, man, you killing it too, bro. You know, sometimes.
And then it ain't genuine.
Exactly. You need to just hold that. Nigga don't need to expect nothing in return. Nigga just need to hold that, bro. That was some real shit. You know what I'm saying? And it's enough, because a lot of niggas ain't going to let him slide like that. You know what I'm saying? A lot of niggas ain't going, because your intentions were, I saw what your intention was. You know what I'm saying? Your intention was to take something from me and get out of here. You know what I'm saying? And sometimes it's rough for us, especially where we come from. We don't usually tap into them emotional side because we risk assessment. If you would take my car, you would kill me. That's, you know, those things are cousins in my opinion. You know what I'm
saying? Yeah, absolutely.
So it's like a nigga don't really know, man. But did anybody, you know, with you sparing that young brother, did anybody spare you coming up? Did anybody give you, you know, an opportunity when you was maybe should have faced a greater consequence? Did they just gave you some game?
Man, I ain't even gonna lie to you, man. Like the you know, just everything I went through dealing with the court system at a young age, you know, I think you know, the troubles I talked about when I, you know, when I got caught with a gun at school, you know, a year before Columbine happened, this was like, this was the ending of 97, the beginning of 98, you know, so I got, you know, I got railroaded like that, you know, but at the same time, you know, like, I knew, you know, everybody in my family had my back, everybody in my family believed in me, and so that made a difference, my mom's, my grandmother, everybody, all my uncles, everybody supported me. Then nobody really talked negative about the situation at hand. You know, they were just like, we're going to get through it. God willing. Sure. And that's just what happened. So, I mean, I went through all that. I went back to the same school, like I said, and still graduated a year later than what I was supposed to. And from that point on, man, I started looking at my friends a little different. Like, it was still my friends. You know, like just my regular friends and the people in the set, you know, and then cousins and stuff like that. So I just started looking at people totally different. Like, you know, I can chill and politic with them all day long, but I might not need to do what they do. You know what I'm saying? I need to take a different route. Now, I can hang out in the hood with you, but I can't hang out with y'all all day. You know what I'm saying? I had other stuff going on. You know, I had a child at a young age. So I had other responsibilities that other people didn't have at a young age. So I had that kind of stuff going on.
But you know what? It again, he lucky that a gentleman that had that level of understanding caught him, man, because it's a lot of niggas that even I know in my hood and in hoods all across the world that had them kids and it don't register. You know, all the time them kids don't register for a young nigga out there that's outside with a certain level of, you know, whether you get money or just a lot of times the young niggas ain't getting no money. They just it's just a lot of activity going on. One day they might
get. You know,
go ahead.
No, you good. I spoke to one of my homeboys out of talent, you know, my homeboy Dre Nino. And the only thing I regret about the situation but not doing, I should have put some money in their pocket. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I should have put some money in the pocket. I talked to one of my OGs. Like I said, my dog showed genuine love when I was down in Tallahassee. So y'all, when me and him were talking about the situation, he was like, man, you should have took a jig and just put a couple $100 in the pocket.
Yeah, for sure. Just,
you know, like that would have changed. That would have also changed the narrative too. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, we spared him, but then we also changed the narrative to, you know, he got to steal from everybody. You know, you could have asked one of your OGs or one of the guys that you see over here in the hood, man, if you having hard times, man, come up to us, let us know what's going on, man. Tell us what's going on. We see it sometimes.
Right.
You know, you see it on the kids sometimes when they struggling, man. It's between the age of 11 and 14, and he out here stealing car, man. It's something else going on at home. So, and you can't fault the parent. Yeah, look, we just went through a pandemic. You don't know what people going through.
Made a lost their job due to the mandate that's going on or anything.
Absolutely. So, you know, it's a domino effect. You know what I'm saying? So I mean, but all of this stuff was contributing factors, man. Like I looked at, like I said, I looked at it totally different. Like I went in harm's way. You know, what I paid car insurance for, but at the same time, you know, like I said, I could have shot him for 30 yards, but he let me got up on him. You know what I'm saying? And it is what it is.
Now, let me ask you this. You think he would have hit the gas while you were running to the car? Let's, because, you know, 10 seconds would have changed that. Had you been 5 or 10 seconds later on looking and actually, instead of seeing him going to the car, seeing him shut the door, and by the time you running out, he kind of getting in gear, do you think you would have fired at him or would you would have?
Well, at the same time, I still want to fire it. You know, I would have fired.
You know, not knowing who it is, it's just you see your car. You know, you was a little late on the watch.
But you know what? People think two different ways. Like how I look at it, how somebody else view it is totally different. Anybody else would have shot their window or shot the whole car, right? Me, I would have hit the tire. I would have disabled the vehicle.
Exactly.
You know. Yeah, you know, instead of hitting the window, or hitting the, you know, looking for a headshot with him. My seat's white. I don't want to go through all that.
Sure.
I still got to drive that car. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? I still got to keep that Benz. You know what I'm saying?
Yo.
You know, I don't, then when something happened to somebody, man, you clean it up yourself.
Yeah, I know that. For sure.
You know what I'm saying? You clean it up yourself, man. These people ain't never had nobody die in front of them. They don't die in their house, man. You clean that blood up yourself.
Yes, Lord.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, so I would
call from the inbound with their blood still all in it and shit. They don't got nothing.
Still all in it. 30 days later, that blood is still in there. You probably wouldn't even got your car back the same day. You know, they're keeping it G. I would have tried to, you know, disable my vehicle, hit the tire or something.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
It's sad that there was a kid, man. You know, I hate to see a kid put themselves in a grown man situation like that. But sometimes the circumstances in the hood, like we say, the lack of resources or, you know, the mama not being able to be as influential in him eating and shit. Niggas is sometimes people can't get a meal, man. It's shit rough, man.
I mean, and Jeff, from looking at Jit, man, Jit looked like he was going through it, man. Jit looked like he needed some water. Like he needed some food, man. You know, you can see the desperation on his face. You know what I'm saying? Like, he needed this to work. He needed this one play to work. It looked like it. You know what I'm saying? Body language tell a lot. Your physical appearance tell a lot, man. It's a lot. You know, everything will contribute to factor, man. I'm just glad that he surrendered and got out of the car.
And I'm
glad he went with a group of people, because, like I said, it would have turned out totally different, you know. That's just what it is.
Let me ask you this. With you being caught with a gun in school, what's your feelings on what's going on in Texas? You familiar with that? The school shooting that happened where the bullying was going on? And what's your feeling on that? I mean, you know, I really don't know how to feel about it. What's your feeling on it?
You know, that situation right there was totally different from my situation. Right. My situation, like, it wasn't no bullying.
You know, it wasn't no bullying.
You know, I'm carrying a pistol for protection.
Right.
I'm carrying a pistol because every day they ride down, every day rival gangs ride down Lincoln Street and they shoot my school up. You know, we only had two Kevin police officers. We might have had one and then maybe an assistant.
Maybe pussy.
You know, what I'm saying? So you know, every day I'm walking home from school until I'm able to drive. So I'm walking home, but they shooting it up 30 minutes straight. You know, and the firearm was for protection. It wasn't for bullying. Now that's totally different. Bullying where I'm from, you know, you just had to deal with it. You had to fight your way out of it.
I'm more so not talking about the bullying. I'm more so talking about just being caught with the firearm. You know, because there was some pushback with him getting out of jail and them doing a welcome home party. So white America took that as a slap in the face, right? Because school shootings, see, and yours is totally different because it didn't turn out to be a school shooting. But with you being in a situation to be caught with a firearm at on campus, it's like it just made me think about, damn, look what's going on in Texas. Now, again, white people push back on the welcome home party. You know, I don't know how to feel about that. Now, they also had some come out today where the chief of police said that he has no evidence of bullying taking place, saying they're trying to kind of mask it under bullying. What do you with children, right? Because they face a whole bunch of stuff. Sometimes them stealing and being in circumstances that they are with you is because of the bullying that comes from, man, them dirty ass shoes. Man, look at the little nigga shirt. Boy, the boy's shirt got holes in it. So now they risking everything to try to, and I can't keep wearing this shirt. They tearing my mouth out at school. You know what I'm saying? So do you think those two things are cousins? Do you think anybody is justified?
Oh yeah, for sure. You know, like you mean your clothes do play a contributing factor on you getting bullied at school.
Right.
You know, I didn't have to go through that. You know, I remember being in elementary school and the joint dropping through the weekday, right? I didn't really realize how much of a sneakerhead my mama was.
My mama
used to come up to the school, elementary school, and bring the joints up to the school, right? Have me put them on and walk me back in the classroom in front of everybody.
Me too.
So I didn't get it. It's
crazy.
Yeah, so I ain't get it.
That's crazy you saying that, bro. My mama done the same thing.
That's crazy.
Crazy, bro. Go ahead, my bad, bro. That's crazy.
Yeah. That's crazy. And to this day, my mama was 63. Yeah, my mama was 63. So to this day, like, my mama's still a sneakerhead. Like, to this day, like, my mama got off-white forces and stuff like that. To this day, man, I still remember, like, my mama used to iron my clothes for the whole week. So it wasn't that. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't that. Yeah, it wasn't that. You know, we kept that shit on.
Right.
You know, and so the bullying part of, you know, like, shit, I mean, I got, you know, I mean, I felt like I would be a drill.
Right.
You know, my mom ironed my clothes for the whole week, put them on the door. I knew what I was wearing.
Right, right. Me too. Yeah. And we got to really give it up for mamas like that, though. Like, my mama keep it all way gangster. She really, I was really cleaner than my mama. Really, nigga, I was cleaner than everybody. School, she was making show look. But the fucked up thing was, I was still in the projects.
Yeah, we were too. We were too.
Yeah, see, that's the only thing. I was still in them bricks, but mama was making show, you know, that when I represent her, I'm on all time high time. Yeah, I'm looking like every time. Now,